Sonic had a great transition into 3D. What, expecting me to say anything else? It's true! Aside from the really early attempts at 3D with stuff like 3D Blast and Sonic Extreme, Sonic's first 3D game, Sonic Adventure, was a great first step into a new dimension, evolving the characters, the setting, the story, and the gameplay to higher levels never seen before. Even if you don't like the game or think it aged poorly or whatever, no one can deny the huge amount of love Sonic Team had for the series. You can see the ambition shining through every part of the game, from the great heights to the less great parts. And that same ambition and love followed the next couple Sonic games. The dark and hero duality of Sonic Adventure 2, the power of teamwork of Sonic Heroes, the moral choices of Shadow the Hedgehog, the life lessons of Sonic and the Black Knight, the journey of discovering who we are from Sonic Unleashed, and even the huge combination of emotions and themes from Sonic 06. None of them are perfect games. Some are not even good, but that didn't matter to me and thousands of people, because we could still enjoy the good side of these titles. We can see the ambition, the passion, the love. But critics didn't care about that. They just saw the glitches, the weird stories, and the pace-breaking gameplay. So then Sonic, just as fast as he runs, became the laughingstock of the whole video game industry. And after that, we got games like Color Generation, Lost World, and Forces. And while two of those games are some of my personal favorites in the franchise, I can't deny something was lost. The characters felt like flat imitations, the gameplay felt scared of evolving the franchise, and everything had to be a joke. And after Sonic Forces becoming the culmination of everything wrong in this new modern Sonic era, something needed to change. And that something, after 5 years in the making, is Sonic Frontiers, the next step into a new era. And let me be real with you, after playing it and completing it for myself, I can confidently say that this game has issues, a ton of them, issues that can easily ruin the experience for many, but to me, this game might have just saved the franchise. And today, I'm here to tell you why. So get ready, let's reach this new frontier. Quick warning before we start, this review will contain the heavy spoiler for Sonic Frontiers, so if you haven't played the game, go do it. While I don't think it's a game for everyone, I would absolutely recommend it. But I will say that for this review, I was playing the PC version of the game, and while I don't have the most powerful supercomputer in the world, you still need a pretty decent PC to run this game. For console players, I heard every version runs and looks pretty good, aside from the popping, but we'll get to that. Sadly, 60 FPS is only for PS5 and Xbox Series X. Hey, post-production Sonico here. During the editing of this video, a new update came out that fixed a couple glitches and gave Xbox Series S a 60 FPS mode. And while I'm here, it's probably a good time to say that this review is based on the base game of Sonic Frontiers. So things like that previous mentioned update, the Monster Hunter DLC, or any other future updates will not be mentioned on this video. Seeing how crazy exciting the roadmap for this game looks, maybe once all the DLC is out, I will do a second review of this game in its completed form. With all that said, back to the video. Which is a shame, since that increased frame rate makes the game feel way better than 30. So if you have one of those newer consoles, you can turn that 60 FPS mode on frame 1. Do not use the 4K version, trust me. Nintendo Switch on the other hand. Honestly, kind of impressed it doesn't burn your house when you play it, so that's good. If you really don't have any other platform to play it on, go ahead, I guess. Hey, at least not a cloud version, unlike some other games. But still, no matter what version you get, the game looks beautiful. Maybe even the best looking Sonic game. I know some people don't really like the realistic art style, but in my opinion, I really like the clash of Sonic elements and more realistic environments. It's not like in OC where they just put Sonic in a realistic world, they actually adjusted everything to not look off but still keep some sort of clash, making Sonic stand out. And that day and night cycle? Incredible. The lighting effects were already beautiful in Forces, but Sonic Frontiers takes them to another level. Again, we will get to that, to the actual review. The first thing I wanted to try was the controls. How does Sonic feel. Actually, pretty good. Taken from the modern boost games with some Adventure, O6, Lost World and even many inspirations, by taking those styles and making it its own different version of Sonic. Or rather, your version of Sonic. Because in a surprising turn, the game gives you a ton of options on how Sonic controls, from acceleration to turning speed to boost speed to everything in between. And while someone can probably make the best setup to make Sonic feel the best it can in this game, trust me when I say that if you play Sonic games often, you crank everything to the max and never look back. In my experience, it gives you the greatest sense of control you can have in Sonic Frontiers, and if you follow my advice, you will quickly find that Sonic controls good. You can actually make a circle while boosting! God forces made the bar too low! But I'm getting ahead of myself. No matter what option you take, you always have the same moveset. As mentioned before, you have the boost from the modern games, but not feeling as fast as those games, working more like a run button. Which sounds bad at first, but I feel like it was a necessary change for this game to make Sonic feel controllable, but still keeping that sense of speed from those boost games. And if you get the max ring count, Sonic gets a huge speed increase. Even taking some cues from movie Sonic without the electricity effects, which, super small, tiny nitpick that doesn't affect the game, but I don't like how Sonic now has lightning powers instead of wind. Lightning is just super common for fast superheroes, while wind feels more like a Sonic element. From the different wind attacks to him being called the Knight of the Wind in Black Knight, it's just an aspect of Sonic character that is kinda lost nowadays. But okay, that ultra small nitpick aside, you also have a double jump like in Colors and Forces. I've never been a fan of the double jump of those games, but I'm shocked to say that this is probably one of the best double jumps in gaming. It's precise, it feels good, and it doesn't completely kill your momentum. We will get to that. You also get an air boost that basically works like a triple jump, which allows you to make some crazy jumps and skips. Aside from that, you also get other moves like the homing attack, quick step, stomp, slide, crouch, light dash, climb, wall run, a bounce attack kind of move working more like the ground pound jump of Mario Odyssey, and probably more that I forgot. With so many moves, they had to get a little creative to get them all to fit in a standard controller without overlapping, like having the light speed dash on the left stick click, the boost on the right trigger, and having the homing attack on X, which sounds super weird, and at first they were. But once my brain got used to it, I never had an accidental death like in Unleash or the Adventure games where they mapped the same button to multiple actions. And having the homing attack being a different button from the double jump and boost makes it so you can make some even bigger jumps. And still on the topic of the homing attack, the reason why they changed the button placement is because that same homing attack button is now your overall attack button. That's right, now we have a full combat moveset. Aside from Boom, which had an awful combat system, and maybe O6 with Shadow, the only other game with this same degree of combat was Sonic Unleashed, which was actually pretty fun once you start unlocking your moves, the problem being that it was locked behind the Werehog and completely went against Sonic's speed. Now in Sonic Frontiers, the combat feels just as fast and snappy as Sonic himself. Have dodges, a parry, really cool looking special moves that you unlock with a skill tree. You can also upgrade your stats by visiting the Elder and Hermit Coco and giving them the seeds of powers and defense, or by collecting these small creatures called the Cocos. No, they are not a ripoff from the Koroks of Zelda. It's just a case of two Japanese companies referring to the same Japanese thing. And yes, I love them. But by far the biggest new move is the side loop. Hold the button, draw a circle, and stuff happens. Pretty simple move in concept, but has a ton of uses. Turn off torches, attack enemies, activate challenges, get rings and other collectibles, launch enemies to the sky for a combo follow-up, give you an infinite boost for a limited time if you draw an infinite symbol. Cut grass. When in doubt, your side loop. It's such a cool mechanic that I would love to see more of in the future. Maybe lean more into the drawing aspect like with the infinite boost, but either way, I really like this move, especially when unlocking the quick side loop. It made the combat super fun, and honestly I would have liked it to be unlocked from the start. But who cares about all those great movement options if you have nothing to do with them? Unlike with previous Sonic games, Sonic Frontiers tries a new gameplay style with the so-called open zone, where you run around freely to collect stuff that allows you to collect more stuff, which allows you to collect more stuff to then fight the Titan at the end to move on to the next island. The gameplay loop doesn't really expand from my oversimplification, but how you get these collectibles is the interesting stuff. I mentioned the term open zone before, and while at first it only seemed like an excuse for it to not be compared to other open world games, after playing it, this term might actually be a perfect way to describe this gameplay style, taking the freedom and the huge areas of open world games and combining it with the platforming and more Sonic-esque elements like the rails and springs that we know from the series. How Sonic Frontiers combined these elements is by putting small platforming sections all over the place, which land you to the sky with a memory token. By themselves, these segments are not big game design, but the sheer length and the way you can use this segment to chain different platforming sections with another, or by launching to reach a higher ledge, is what makes this style truly amazing. And not to mention the beautiful music, proving that you can have a banger soundtrack that also fits the more relaxed atmosphere of an open world game. Every open zone has its own set of songs that perfectly encapsulate the mood and get progressively more lively the more you complete the island. It's an incredible combination of mysterious, dark, dangerous, sad, relaxing, energetic, and hopeful. It puts any other open world soundtrack to shame. Those three piano notes from Breath of the Wild? Talk about boring. Tomoya Otani out here being the GOAT! Going back to the gameplay, in my opinion, this is when Sonic Frontiers succeeds. Mastering Sonic's movement and mechanics to enter a flow state where you are just running around doing whatever, having fun by only playing the game without interruption. It's incredible. And then you add the sense of discovering something new, like with the great amount of collectibles or the little challenges that lock your map and create ancient grind rails that works as fast travel. You start thinking of the islands less as places and more like a toolbox of possibilities. And when I finally remembered that this game has story objectives, I was greeted with one of the best stories in a Sonic game. God damn me, and Flynn, how are you so good at your job? So the story goes as follows. Sonic and his friends, Tails and Amy, go to the mysterious Starfall Islands in search of the Chaos Emeralds that have all reunited in the Zero Islands for unknown reason. But as soon as they get to their destination, they get trapped in a digital dimension of cyberspace, with the only one that managed to escape being Sonic. Now him, with the assistance of a totally not the final boss guiding him, he must rescue his friends, get the Chaos Emeralds, and discover the great mystery of the Starfall Islands. It's a pretty interesting premise. We get a completely new location this time, and we have a new angle to the story that hasn't been done before. Some people got annoyed at how little they showed the story in the marketing, but I think it was for the better. I was genuinely interested in knowing who are the Coco, what happened to the Ancients. Yes, that's their name, I can already feel the Kirby PTSD coming through. What is their connection to the Chaos Emerald? Who was the great enemy they fought? What is cyberspace? And so many other questions. But what really kept me engaged in the story was that they finally did something I was waiting for years. We got continuity! I know the power is low, but let me have this! Instead of every game basically resetting everything like nothing in the other games matter, Sonic Frontiers, on the other hand, constantly references the other Sonic games. And yeah, you could say it can get annoying and that they're just doing references for the sake of references, but I would completely disagree. The references are there to expand the world and show that the characters are aware of previous events. They connect those previous elements to this new set of characters and the great lore that we got from the game. Again, the Ancients are such a cool concept that connects to so many other elements like the Chao, the Echidnas, Chaos. The Chaos Emerald got an origin story? And it still leaves tons of questions that make you invested. Like, why was the Master Emerald still on Earth? Did the Ancients make the Emeralds or did they just use them? Stuff like that is so cool. The only question Forge left me was, what the f*** happened here? Probably the reason why this story is so good is because of Ian Flynn's great writing. You probably know him, started his career by writing, or should I say fixing, for the Archie comics and then went on to write the IDW comics. I haven't read much of his Archie run, but I have read all of IDW, and trust me when I say he's the GOAT. I don't know how much involvement in the story itself he had, but from just the dialogue alone, yeah, this is Ian Flynn being Ian Flynn. You can tell from little things like Eggman calling his personal network the Eggnet, or by Sonic referencing to some enemies as Super Badniks, concepts that were first created in IDW and are brought back to the main canon. But even outside of that, this characterization, oh my god! I haven't felt this way with this character since Black Knight, and I love it! The way Sonic interacts with Amy, Knuckles, and especially Tails, completely overshadows the overall story. How all these characters talk to each other feels like they're trying to fix the problems of the modern games, but they don't ignore it. In a shocking way, they take the bad characterization of those games and revert them to how they were in Adventure and Dark Eras, while giving them new arcs and setting them up for possibly new games. Just like the gameplay itself, the story loop is also pretty simple first. You get them out of the cyber prisons, they find a Coco that represents them, we help the Coco with their problems, we get the Chaos Emeralds on the way, we get a flashback of the Ancients, and the characters share their problems with Sonic. But it's the conversation itself that I love. Amy wanting to help a Coco find their love, leading to her decision of exploring the world to share that same love with the world is a perfect evolution of the kindness in her heart that made both Gamma and Shadow reflect on their actions, making them better people, showing that even if Amy is not that strong, her love for others can change the world. Or looking at Knuckles, wanting to help the Coco Warriors even though he knows nothing can change their fate, being a parallel to both his commanding role in Forces and to him being the last of the Echidnas, not wanting the Cocos to meet the same end. The way he and Sonic show a brotherly rivalry, constantly mocking each other while helping the other when necessary, and when he tells Sonic that he feels lonely in the island, and the conversation of the whole cutscene is just heartwarming, man. But Tails though, oh my god, my boy is back, he's finally back! He brings up the events of the other games to tell Sonic that he's starting to feel like a burden to him, and him eventually coming around and telling Sonic that he wants to go on his own adventures to grow up is such a perfect way to progress his characters, and it feels so real too! We all have insecurities, even if we show that we can get over them, it doesn't mean that we truly get over them. And that sometimes we need other people to show us what we can do, and stop being clouded by our own negative feelings. Tails has always been my favorite character because of his journey, looking up to Sonic as his role model, that to me felt very relatable as a kid. And now, as a soon to be young adult, the lesson Tails learned in this game resonated with me so much. But then we have Sonic himself. Talk about a roller coaster of emotions! From absolutely hating how he sounds in the game, to him becoming the absolute best aspect of the story? Roger's performance really grew on me as the game went on. I still think he isn't the best Sonic, but goddamn, this game made me like him way more than before. About the personality itself, it's basically perfect. He still has a cheeky, snarky side, but not in an annoying Baldy McNoser type of way. He still throws jokes from time to time, but they feel natural. When shit gets serious, he is too, and how he interacts with his friends is just sublime. When Tails asks Sonic if he's a burden, Sonic just brushes off like a stupid question, which might sound tone deaf at first, but that's just because to him, it is a stupid question. Sonic would never consider Tails as a problem. He can recognize the good in Tails and uses examples from other games like Adventure and Lost World to prove it. When he talks to Knuckles, Sonic tries to be his snarky usual self, but identifies that Knuckles is really going through it and becomes more serious. After they talk it out, he goes back to the more playful side, showing that brotherly side that I talked about earlier. And there are so many other examples of Sonic being both cheeky and serious when needed. Like when Sage asks him what is his end goal.
It varies. Sometimes it's a spinning sign, sometimes it's a big old ring.
Oh yeah, Sage! Sage is a new character introduced in this game, and what a great one at that. Being an AI made by Eggman that absorbs some energy from cyberspace, Sage presents herself as the main antagonist to Sonic, trying to constantly stop him from progressing, being by angering the Titans to attack Sonic, or just by talking shit. You can tell from a distance that she's not the main threat and that Sage might be hiding a lot of information from us. But as the game progresses, Sage starts to notice the conversation Sonic has with his friends and she starts understanding different emotions, even to the point of feeling sad that she has no one like Sonic and his friends. She starts treating Eggman as his father, wondering of meeting her brothers, Orbot and Cubot. Eggman created her to steal the ancient technology and to stop Sonic, that's why she doesn't tell you anything at the start. But by the end, she's the one that makes Eggman work with Sonic. Sage is the perfect representation of Sonic Frontiers, a blend of new and old ideas to make something special. Something that feels like Sonic, but at the same time is completely different from what came before. I think that's what makes Sonic Frontiers one of the best games in the series. The story, the gameplay, everything comes together to make something truly special. And yet, Some of you are wondering why I'm leaving out so many crucial parts of this game. The cyberspace stages, the combat, the curtains, the puzzles, fishing, the last two islands, and the ending. And that's because Sonic Frontiers is not a perfect shining star. Let's not waste any more time. This game has issues, and I'm not going to leave out the truth. Let's start by talking about one of the most important parts of this game, the cyberspace stages.
Oh boy, I wonder what new locations this new Sonic game has!
Okay, where do I even start? During your travels, you will find deactivated cyberspace portals that will send you to these cyberspace stages. To actually activate them, you need portal gears that you get from defeating amiibos or by exploring the world. These levels are your more traditional boost formula stages. Just get to the end as fast as possible. From these levels, you get bulk keys that open the way to the chaos levels. You can get even more bulk keys by getting an S rank, collecting enough rings, and by getting the fire red star rings. Let's get the elephant out of the room. It's been, what, 11 years in generations, and we are still using Green Hill Chemical Plant Sky Sanctuary? At least this city theme is semi-unique. And despite there being 30 cyberspace levels in total, these 4 themes I mentioned, that's it! Well, it doesn't matter as long as the levels I can keep it up. About that. Level themes are not the only thing they took this time. Most, but not all, trying to be fair here, of the cyberspace levels are taken straight from Sonic Adventure 2, Sonic Unleashed, and Sonic Generations. God f***ing damn it! What's worse is that these cyberspace stages have amazing music! Botani is still going for that electronic style from Forces, which I didn't really like in that game, but on Frontiers is so much better. The problem is that all these stages blend together because of only having 4 level themes and by having the most basic 2D Mario looking ass names like 1-1 and 1-2, making the songs feel disconnected from the stage itself, which makes them less special, less memorable. Like, yeah, I can tell you 4-1 is a banger, but you are seeing gameplay of 2-4 with 3-7 playing on the background, and you didn't even notice, did ya? What's weird that in the soundtrack themselves, these songs do have names, so why not use these names on the actual game? Even still, it would have been fine if Sonic felt good to control. I mean, open world Sonic is a joy to play with. So what the f*** happened here? For one, the boost is not even close to be as fast as in the boost game, so Sonic feels really slow, turning is mega fast, and jumping completely kills your momentum, making it feel awful. This last problem is also a problem with the open zone. The second jump is amazing, but that first jump ruins so much of the floor. I'm out here making a huge run from rails doing tricks after jumping in some springs, but then I want to jump from one side to the other, and Sonic just slows down to a crawl, to the point that you need the double jump and air dash for even the smallest of gaps. And I think this game would have been way better if it just had a little bit more momentum in that initial jump. The difference is that the open world was built around this limited momentum. In cyberspace, this Sonic was not built for these stages. While the Adventure 2 levels feel good, if not great, the normal generation and Unleashed are so bad. But even still, giving it the absolute benefit of the doubt, maybe somehow the mission can save them. There's a slight chance I'm not giving them enough of a chance, and grind them out for those S-Runs will let me discover that Sonic magic of understanding the mechanics and using them for speedrunning. And in the case of a stage like 1-2, you would be correct. For some, getting this S-Run was super infuriating, but for me, it was incredible. Learning the physics, planning out the perfect route, executing everything without fail, it was a journey of mastery that I haven't felt since getting the A ranks in the speed stages of Adventure 2. It might have only taken me like 8 minutes to complete, compared to the hours that some others took to do it, but it was leagues better than anything from Generation, and especially Forces. Too bad it was also leagues better than any other stage in this f***ing game! Why is the second cyberspace level the hardest one?
Every other stage was super easy, I was well over 30 seconds, even a full minute from beating the S rank. I even got the most etching for the red star rings, which are some of the easiest red star rings in any Sonic game, by the way. In fact, in many cases, I got all the missions on my first try! We have reached bottom of the f***ing barrel, folks. But fine, it's not the end of the world, it's optional. Too bad everything else is also kinda mediocre. The combat was fun at first, but it's way more flash over substance. Just do a ton of random special attacks and win. The challenges that unlock parts of your map are lame and super easy. The only ones I liked were the time trial ones. Every other one is brain dead simple. The parry one was actually neat at first, but then I discovered that parry needs no timing. Just hold the bumpers and win. Those are the challenges that you find freely on the open zones. The ones needed for story progression don't range from funny and fun to I'm sorry, no banger music in the universe can distract me from the fact this build machine needs 5 million points to beat, and if you run out of tries then you have to do the whole thing again. It's not hard, I did it on my second try and it's only a single table that makes the pinball from Mania Plus look like big game design, but it's still a Discord pinball, which means that bullshit can and will happen! But the islands themselves are not perfect. Sonic is too magnetized to the floor, leading to camera shaking or in some instances to just sink to the ground the moment you run off a ledge. Or if not, Sonic can be sent to the skies for no f***ing reason, which is hilarious, but not ideal. The Elder Coco takes a million f***ing years to level up your speed and ring capacity, unlike the Chad Hermit Coco that does it almost instantly. The cutscenes have amazing dialogue and the story is incredible, but most of the cutscenes themselves are so stiff and boring and the lip sync is completely off sometimes. Like, god damn, move a little! And the puppet. I will defend a little by saying that Sonic moves really fast so it's harder to optimize, and the fact people seemingly forget that other open world games also have tons of popping in, so saying that Sonic Frontiers is the only game with popping is the biggest lie in existence. But just because it's Sonic, then it's a problem. Thank god Pokemon Scarlet and Violet came out a few weeks after this game to show the reality of the situation. You cannot look at that game and still say this sort of shit. I'm so sick of this double standard that appears every time a Sonic game does anything. And then if you try to understand it, not even defend it, people say, oh my god, these Sonic fans really need a good game. And being honest, when you start playing the game, you start forgetting about the popping. It never made me miss a jump or crash into a wall. With that rant over, oh my god, this is bad! I get there being popping, but this much? Maybe add some fading, dithering, make a lower poly version when it's far from the camera, make those elements go at a lower frame rate. I don't know, I'm not a game developer, but there has to be something to make it better. Maybe this is the Hedgehog Engine 2 being a beautiful but horrible engine, but still, this is not good. But it's not only the technical problems that bother me. You know how I praise all the cute little references in the cutscene to other games that make the whole series feel connected? Well, for the first time since Adventure 1, Jesus Christ, Sonic will commentate on his surroundings, most of the time doing references to other characters and locations, and there are a ton of different things Sonic can say. That's so cool! But don't remember Sonic talking to me that much, you might say. And that's because you have to stand still for 10 f***ing minutes for him to talk? Why? I want to hear your beautiful voice, Sonic! Talk to me! And remember all those fun bite-sized platforming challenges placed all around the island? Well, those are fun, until you get to Chaos Island, where most of the challenges lock you in 2D, so if you already got the memory token before, you have to either find a way to fail it, or just beat it again. What's worse is that you can be having the time of your life, but then you run into a boost pad that you didn't see before that locks you in a 2D section, completely ruining that sense of flow. There is also the Starfall event where every couple of 90 star bits from Mario Galaxy appear on the island, and you can collect them to spin a slot machine to get purple coins. Not only is this busted for farming purple coins and makes the one you find normally obsolete, but the giant slot machine is right in front of the screen, annoying you all night. It also takes 5 years to spin, so I can't even gamble right. Or at least that would be the case, but you can press up on the D-pad to spin it faster? Why doesn't the game tell you this? And okay, let's talk about the last two islands. this game was marketed as having 5 big islands to explore, when in reality it's more like 4.5. The 4 islands just a lot dump with big towers to climb. It's fun and I was really interested in the story, but it's super clear that it was supposed to be part of Chronos Island that was cut and became Rhea Island, seeing how it looks exactly the same. Like, you can explore also the tower and find a ton of cool places, even getting to see Chronos Island right next to you. But it doesn't matter since the only thing you need to do is to climb those towers. What's more, when you complete the map of Chronos Island, you can see some parts outside of what you can explore, and comparing that map to Rhea Island, yeah. This island is also home to the biggest missed opportunity in the story. So after saving each of his friends, Sonic gets a little bit more corrupted by cyberspace, to the point that after Sonic saves Tails, he looks like he's about to die in any second, culminating in Sonic freezing like a stone, seemingly dying after bringing his friends back from the dimension in between cyberspace and the real world. And after the whole gang and Eggman see Sonic these days, I thought, oh, is it going to be like 06 where you control all these characters in order to save Sonic? No. Instead, we just hold hands using the power of friendship and now Sonic is back to normal. Well, that was underwhelming. Sonic being corrupted with some strange source and he having to persevere through sheer strength and love of his friends is such a cool and interesting concept. A concept so cool and interesting that we already had in IDW with the Metal Virus saga. So comparing that incredible comic arc, which you guys should totally read, IDW Sonic is Peak Fiction, with this, makes it even more lame. What's worse is that a similar thing happened in the final island, Ouroboros Island. The island itself works just as any other one, with all the platforming challenges, cyberspace, enemies, chaos emeralds, and more that you expect from the other islands. But it still looks exactly the same as Chronos Island. They even use the same memory token from Chronos Island. And would you look at that? Just like with Rhea Island, Ouroboros Island was part of Chronos but got separated into its own at the last second, which makes it feel super underwhelming. Same thing can be said with the final bosses. Supreme is just a more annoying version of Giganto that doesn't even know its own gimmick. What you're supposed to do is take down one of the drones to attack Supreme, but one, you can just say fuck it and just attack Supreme normally. He does throw you off, but it's more like an annoyance that actually preventing you from attacking him. And two, if you actually try to do what you're supposed to do, after the first drone, Supreme will do an attack that if you parry will kill every other drone, so the gimmick just falls flat on his face. Then in the second part, he gets cool looking wings and a gun during the cutscene, but during the gameplay, he just doesn't use them. Rather working the same as phase 1, but with a ton of small projectiles that push you a little. Again, not hard or interesting, just annoying. And who had the horrible idea of playing I'm Here and having the lyrics only come out on the second half of the second phase? I waited so long to hear the full version of I'm Here in-game after falling completely in love with the short version on YouTube. Even after the song got leaked a few weeks before release, I resisted because I want to have the best experience. But by the time the lyrics started, I'd already beaten the boss, which just made the fight even more underwhelming. And then for the true final boss, which you can only play by being in hard mode, we have Dien. Better original name, by the way. This is just f***ing Ikaruga! It reminds me a lot of Kirby games, where the final boss or one of the final bosses are usually a shoot 'em up of some sort. But unlike with Kirby, there is no other final boss to get that ultimate test of your abilities. Not to mention the end has its own set of issues outside of being a drastic change of gameplay style. So you take the hacking minigame, make it 10 million years to beat, with attacks that you literally can't react on your first try, and if you take more than 3 hits, you have to start all over again. See the problem? It's not that hard, I beat it on my 3rd real try, because if you get hit before the second half, you'll restart it, it's not worth it, but it just takes so long. And at some point, you start doing zero damage because the end has to give his long speech of how he's the most powerful thing in the universe and how Sonic has fought God before, but he's stronger than all of them, and this and that. I'm like, bro, you're literally a moon. I didn't say it before, but the end is just the AI voice that has been guiding Sonic to free them from cyberspace. And while a cool concept of us actually being the bad guys that freed his god of destruction by accident, the end had almost no presence in the game, and it felt really rushed. And with these two bosses being reskins of another boss and a minigame,
The Last Island being cut part of Chronos Island, the story and trying to wrap us as fast as possible, they ran out of money and time, didn't they? Because it's a shame, I can see so many good things in this game, but because of budget constraints, a pandemic, and only being developed by 60 people, this game was an ambitious project, but was sabotaged by Sega, just like many, many Sonic games before. And still, even with all those problems, Sonic Frontiers manages to pick itself up from the shadows and shines like no other Sonic game has before. And I realized this the moment I got that 7 Chaos Emerald for the first time. Holy shit! I have no idea how I managed to contain myself from talking about these Titan fights! This is the coolest shit that I've ever done with Sonic! A Super Sonic fight that controls just like a stronger and cooler Sonic instead of changing the gameplay style in an annoying way like every other Super Sonic fight! Incredible cinematic quick time events where Super Sonic goes crazy! Launching Gigantus to the skies with Asylum! Throwing whatever across the island into a mountain bouncer style, riding the shield of light to crash into him, stopping and launching Gigantus beam, forming a ball of missiles and kicking right into Wyvern's face, or attacking Knight's legs to make him fall, then lashing him into the skies with a spin dash to finally kick him straight back to the ground. And the most important part, the most epic metal songs of your life that make Metal Gear Rising and they'll make Cry 5 blush! Cyberspace and Open Zone songs already made me think this was one of the best Sonic soundtracks ever, but this? It's unreal! Find Your Flame and Undefeatable already became part of my top 10 Sonic songs of all time! And if you know Sonic music, that's insane! There is no words that can describe the feeling that these fights produce in me. They are so incredible that I want to cry of happiness that my Sonic is back. The same one that defeated Perfect Chaos. The same one that stopped the Ark. The same one that erased Solaris from the timeline. The same one that passed right through Dark Gaia's eye. And the same Sonic that became Excalibur to show Merlina the error of her ways. He's back! The same level of excitement from those final fights is here on the first 3 bosses! Like, yeah, they're not perfect, they can get a little bottom mashy, and with the parry being so simple, they have no challenge. But I don't care! Look at the f***ing screen! I'm using Knight's giant sword to split him up in 2 anime style! Look at me, the eyes tell me it's not the coolest shit of your life! And this is the essence of Sonic Frontiers. Not a perfect game, but one that filled me with an incredible amount of joy. And after that first boss, everything just started to make sense and be more fun. The cyberspace stages, those are basically the special stages of the game, so why be so negative? They're supposed to be a nice break from the open zone, and they do that perfectly. The Ryu asset makes it so they could pump out a ton of levels in a short amount of time, and once you get used to the controls, you start to learn and love these stages. Sonic's insane mid-air movement with the double jump, air dash, homing attack made 3D stages like this stage based on Dragon Road Act 2 and all the Adventure 2 levels feel incredible. While making the more platforming heavy 2D levels like this one based on Rooftop Run Act 2 way more fun to control and to skip section than originally in Unleashed. But then I discovered the homing attack cancel, where you can cancel a homing attack with an air dash to go flying. And this completely changed how I approach each cyberspace levels, making one of the worst parts of the game into one of the most fun Sonic games to speedrun. And for the open zone itself, I also started to appreciate aspects that I didn't like at first, like the small challenge that unlocked your map. I know why they're so simple, it's because that way it doesn't ruin the pace. Except the night ones, those still suck. Just like with cyberspace, it's to offer a break from the usual gameplay, and if you don't want to do them, don't do them! Same with the combat, it might be super simple, but the guardians are great. The challenge comes from getting to the phase where you can hit them, and by that point, the flashy yet simple combat becomes exciting again. I didn't like fighting the small normal guys, so I just stopped fighting them. Open zones are so open and offer a million ways of getting what you need, and using the rails you create with the challenges can lead to some crazy jumps. Chaos Island wasn't that bad once I started to experiment more.
using things like the drop dash and rail launch to hop from one island to another was exciting, and then I discovered that the tool section only activate by very specific springs and push pads, which mean that you can access these challenges in 3D and use them to skip other platforming challenges. And despite how lazy the aesthetics of Ouroboros Island are, it's probably my favorite island of the whole game. So many locations, so many unique and fun platforming challenges, so many high level guards to test those combat abilities. It even has a whopping 2 fishing holes! Oh yeah, fishing! I forgot to talk about this earlier, but you can encounter Big the Cat in specific starvers before to play a fishing minigame. I love how they just don't give a reason to why Big is here, just want to fish and somehow got here, and I find that hilarious. The minigame is also pretty simple, but there are a lot of different types of fish and even scrolls that let you fast travel to the Elder and Hermit couple. Couple that with the incredible lo-fi hip-hop beat to fish to music in the background makes it a very relaxing yet fun experience. But what's more important is that you can get tokens using the Pokecoins you collect, and with those tokens you can buy things like cocos, seeds of power and defense, portal gears, memory tokens and more. That means if you don't want to search for something specific, you can just buy it, which might sound broken and kinda is, but it's completely optional and Big is usually hidden well, so it feels rewarding to find him and get what I need. You can also buy Eggman's memo, where we learn about Eggman's side of the story and his thought. And just like other parts of the story, this was a delight. We see how Sage's relationship with Eggman grows throughout the game, but thanks to the memos, we see how the other side of the story plays. How Eggman feels his Sage as a program, to start referring to her as a she instead of a it, to comparing her to Marie and his family, to laughing at her jokes, to start seeing her as his daughter. Yeah, looking such crucial character development behind optional stuff is kinda stupid, and seeing how I literally just made a 30 minute video explaining why I don't like that in Kirby, I really shouldn't be defending this, but I won't lie and say that I absolutely adore these conversations. Mike Polly's Eggman was always incredible, but his performance here, and all the other actors by that matter, is something else. It's also not necessary to understand the overall story, or even to understand why Eggman would feel such an attachment to Sage, because there are story cutscenes where Eggman and Sage share the spotlight, but those memos just make the whole thing way better. Speaking of which, let's wrap this up, shall we? After beating Supreme, Sage takes control of the last Titan with Super Sonic. They go to space to confront the end, but not before Eggman tells Sonic to take care of his daughter. We play some Ikaruga, answer some quick time events and an honestly beautiful finisher, Sage decides that there's only one way to stop this, and that way is to sacrifice herself. After the huge explosion, we see Super Sonic come back from space, meaning his friends that finally escaped cyberspace, and everything seems to be fine. But then we see one of the best scenes in the franchise. Eggman looks at the sky, waiting for Sage on a cliffside. Realizing what happened, he looks at the ground for a second as the beautiful song Dear Father starts playing. Eggman looks back again at the sky, but this time he clenches his fist with determination. Not a single word was said, and yet you can feel every emotion Eggman goes through. We still have some post-credits cutscenes to cover. The first one is of the gang talking to each other of what's to come in their life, even with a final mind-blowing reference to Sticks from Sonic Boom of all games. They all hop in the tornado, looking forward to new frontiers. The final cutscene is of Eggman in a computer room with Sage and that symbol from the first teaser? We don't know much about that, and to some this might take away from the sacrifice, but in my opinion we need to wait for the next game to see where they take this plotline. Either way, it feels sad. Seeing these characters we have all grown up with move on to a different era, this might as well be the end of a chapter for all of them, especially how Amy, Knuckles and Amy all talk about living their usual lives to explore the world. And I still can't process the thought, there is a chance Tails is right and that next time we will reunite with these characters, it will be in a completely new way. And that's both sad and exciting. No matter what's happened to them, I will still be here for all their crazy adventures. Maybe someday having that elusive Sonic Adventure 3. But for now, the future is up in the air, and I can't wait to see what's coming. We'll be right back.
What a game, man. I think I'll talk about everything I want to talk about, but at the same time it feels like I just scratched the surface of my feelings for this game. Sonic Frontiers is an incredible game. It's not perfect, as you can see by my many issues with the game, but it has given me something that I haven't had with this series in 10 years. Hope. This game has so much potential, and I know after 5 years of waiting that might sound bad, but Sonic Frontiers doesn't have wasted potential. The potential is all here. This game is what the series needed to get up on its feet, and in that front it delivers. The open zone gameplay is incredible and the story has never felt more real. I just feel like there are endless possibilities, so that's why I want Sega to look at this game and to give Sonic Team what it deserves. These people are giving their all to keep this fire alive. Give them the budget, time and staff numbers that they need. Listening to the crazy songs with Nate Wants to Battle called One Way Dream, and reading an interview with Tomayo Tani that this song is meant to represent Sonic Team, it puts everything in a different perspective. So to everyone that worked on this game, from the guys at the front like Izuka and Kishimoto, to the voice actors, to the story writers, to the social media team, to anyone else that worked on this game, thank you. You all did something truly special. But what do you guys think about this game? It seems Sonic Frontiers is pretty divided outside the Sonic fandom, where almost everyone here loves it, so it will be interesting to see your opinions down in the comments. And speaking of that community, if you have the PC version, I would really recommend looking at the Game Banana page, because there are already so many mods for this game. Like, Jesus Christ, these guys are insane, even more than Origins had at the beginning, so give that a try if you want. But it's still crazy to say that after so many years, I can proudly say I'm a Sonic fan, and I can't wait to see what this new era has in store. Sonic Frontiers, you are the light in the dark. That's all from me, and I'll see you on the next ride.